Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
5 sentence patterns for beginners. Let's go. Me llamo Rosa. My name is Rosa. Me llamo Rosa. My name is Rosa. Hola, encantada de conocerte. Me llamo Rosa. ¿Cómo te llamas? Hello, nice to meet you. My name is Rosa. What is your name? Tengo 26 años. I am 26 years old. Tengo 26 años. I am 26 years old. Yo tengo 26 años. ¿Y tú? ¿Cuántos años tienes? I'm 26 years old. And you? How old are you? Vivo en Madrid. I live in Madrid. Vivo en Madrid. I live in Madrid. Nací en Granada, pero ahora vivo en Madrid. I was born in Granada, but now I live in Madrid. Me gusta cantar. I like singing. Me gusta cantar. I like singing. Me gusta cantar, cocinar y viajar. También me gustan mucho los animales. I like singing, cooking and traveling. I also like animals a lot. ¿Puedes ayudarme? Can you help me? ¿Puedes ayudarme? Can you help me? ¿Puedes ayudarme, por favor? Can you help me, please? 10 phrases to help you in an emergency. Let's go. Llama a la policía, por favor. Call the police, please. Llama a la policía, por favor. Call the police, please. So if you're in Spain and you need to call the police, you need to dial 091. ¿Tienes fiebre? Do you have a fever? ¿Tienes fiebre? Do you have a fever?
Are you okay? Are you feeling okay?
Perdí mi pasaporte. I lost my passport. Perdí mi pasaporte. I lost my passport. So, yeah, if you lose your passport, go to your embassy, I guess. I hope they will take care of it very soon. Creo que comí algo malo. I think I ate something bad. Creo que comí algo malo. I think I ate something bad. So, I've never tried it, but I heard from a friend that having some charcoal pills really helps when you have eaten something bad. Necesito un médico. I need a doctor. Necesito un médico. I need a doctor. So, if you have any health emergency, you can call 061. No puedo encontrar el camino de vuelta a mi hotel. I can't find the way back to my hotel. No puedo encontrar el camino de vuelta a mi hotel. I can't find the way back to my hotel. Like before, I guess it wasn't that uncommon to be lost, but now that we have like mobile internet everywhere and Google Maps and everything, I think that helped a lot, but still. ¿Hay alguna farmacia cerca? Is there a pharmacy nearby? ¿Hay alguna farmacia cerca? Is there a pharmacy nearby? In Spain, you can easily spot the pharmacies because they have like a big green cross sign on the side. So they are really easy to spot. ¿Me puedes ayudar? Can you help me? ¿Me puedes ayudar? Can you help me? I think in general, Spanish people are very friendly. So I'm sure if you are lost or need something, like you can ask them. Even though we don't speak English super well, I think we'll try to help you. Necesito una ambulancia. I need an ambulance. Necesito una ambulancia. I need an ambulance. So if you need an ambulance, call 061. ¿Podría usar tu teléfono? Could I use your phone? ¿Podría usar tu teléfono? Could I use your phone? Top 20 travel phrases you should know. ¿Cuánto cuesta esto? How much is this? ¿Cuánto cuesta esto? How much is this? You can also say, ¿cuánto vale? ¿Hablas inglés? Do you speak English? ¿Hablas inglés? Do you speak English? In most cases, the answer to that might not be that positive. Yeah, you can try. ¿Me puedo probar esto? Can I try this on? ¿Me puedo probar esto? Can I try this on? So if you enter a clothing store and there's something you like, you can ask the shopping assistant. ¿Me puedo probar esto? ¿Tienes sitio para esta noche? Do you have any vacancies tonight? ¿Tienes sitio para esta noche? Do you have any vacancies tonight? Maybe try to not get to the point in which you have to ask this and book your room beforehand. No. ¿Tienes alguna recomendación? Do you have any recommendations? ¿Tienes alguna recomendación? Do you have any recommendations? Like if you travel to Spain, you have to go to Granada. Cannot miss it. Most beautiful city in the world. Me gustaría 10 de estos. I'd like 10 of these. Me gustaría 10 de estos. I'd like 10 of these. So if you want to buy souvenirs for all your friends and you don't really want to like think a lot, you just can find some, I don't know, keychain or postcard. Say, me gustaría 10 de estos. I would like 10 of these. And it'll be over because it's pretty stressful to find souvenirs for everyone. Me gustaría este. I'd like this. Me gustaría este. I'd like this. So if you're talking to the shopping assistant and maybe the thing you want is a bit further away, like you can point at it and say, me gustaría este. Tengo una reserva. I have a reservation. Tengo una reserva. I have a reservation. So if you really want to go to a restaurant, try to like research a little bit and see if that place is normally full so that you can like make a reservation beforehand. ¿Es este el autobús correcto para el aeropuerto? Is this the right bus for the airport? ¿Es este el autobús correcto para el aeropuerto? Is this the right bus for the airport? Normally going by taxi to the airport is pretty expensive, so you want to check the buses. ¿Es gratis el Wi-Fi? Is the Wi-Fi free? ¿Es gratis el Wi-Fi? Is the Wi-Fi free? The Spanish people have this tendency of saying Wi-Fi even in English because we are so used to call it that way in Spanish. So if someone person is talking to you and say something about Wi-Fi, you know they mean Wi-Fi. ¿Me podría dar un descuento? Could you give me a discount? ¿Me podría dar un descuento? Could you give me a discount? So it's not that common in Spain to ask for a discount in a store. So yeah, maybe if you go to an outdoors market or to these stalls near the beach, you can ask for a discount. ¿Me podría encontrar una habitación para no fumadores? Could you find me a non-smoking room? ¿Me podría encontrar una habitación para no fumadores? Could you find me a non-smoking room? So about smoking, like in Spain, it's forbidden to smoke inside places. And I find it so funny that in Japan it's the opposite, like you cannot smoke outside, but you can smoke in places. I just find it kind of weird. How is it in your country?
¿Podría sacarme una foto, por favor?
Could you take a picture of me, please?
¿Podría sacarme una foto, por favor?
Could you take a picture of me, please? I have the impression that lately, with all these selfie sticks and things, like people are not asking that anymore. But before, like, it was really common to get asked that.
¿Podría tener la cuenta?
Could I have the check?
¿Podría tener la cuenta?
Could I have the check? And also you can just say, la cuenta, por favor. It's the same thing.
¿Tienen algún plato vegetariano?
Do you have any vegetarian dishes?
¿Tienen algún plato vegetariano?
Do you have any vegetarian dishes? So before it wasn't that common, but nowadays there are a lot of vegetarian and vegan places opening in Spain, so it's getting easier. And also, like in normal places, they now have like options for vegetarian people, so yeah, getting easier.
Perdone, ¿cuál es la tarifa?
Excuse me, what's the fare?
Perdone, ¿cuál es la tarifa?
Excuse me, what's the fare? Some museums and monuments sometimes have like a special fare for students, so if you are one, you can maybe ask,
perdone, ¿cuál es la tarifa para estudiantes? ¿Aceptáis tarjeta de crédito?
Do you take credit cards?
¿Aceptáis tarjeta de crédito?
Do you take credit cards? So in most shops in Spain, you can pay by card, there's no problem, but maybe if you go to a small town, go to a small shop, like you might have to pay in cash. So yeah, in these cases, like you can ask this question.
¿Podría darme un mapa?
Could I get a map?
¿Podría darme un mapa?
Could I get a map? I'm so thankful about Google Maps because I have no sense of direction, and even if I have a map, like for me it's so difficult to like understand it and follow it. So yeah, I'm happy there's technology now.
¿Podríamos tener el menú, por favor?
Could we have the menu, please?
¿Podríamos tener el menú, por favor?
Could we have the menu, please? Yeah, if you go to a restaurant, you can ask this question and they'll bring you the menu.
Esto no es lo que pedí.
This isn't what I ordered.
Esto no es lo que pedí.
This isn't what I ordered. Yeah, normally if you get something different from what you ordered and you say this politely, like they will replace it for you. So no problem. Perdona, sorry, but this is not what I ordered. ¿Te importaría cambiarlo? Could you mind to change it?
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
In this video, you'll have a chance to test them out with a quiz. First, you'll see an image and hear the question in Spanish. Next comes a short dialogue. Listen carefully and see if you can answer correctly. We'll show you the answer at the end. Are you ready?
Una mujer le está preguntando algo a un empleado en la librería. ¿Qué libro quería ver la mujer? Disculpe, me gustaría echarle un vistazo al libro en ese estante.
¿Qué libro quiere usted?
El libro sobre carros.
Espere un momento, por favor. ¿Este?
Exactamente.
Aquí tiene.
¿Qué libro quería ver la mujer? Una mujer le está preguntando algo a un empleado en la librería. ¿Qué libro quería ver la mujer? Disculpe, me gustaría echarle un vistazo al libro en ese estante.
¿Qué libro quiere usted?
El libro sobre carros.
Espere un momento, por favor. ¿Este?
Exactamente.
Aquí tiene.
Un hombre y una mujer están viendo el menú en un restaurante. ¿Qué ordenó el hombre?
¿Qué te gustaría ordenar?
Esta pizza se ve deliciosa. La ordenaré.
Yo comí pizza ayer, así que...
Ay, entonces, ¿cómo ves esta hamburguesa?
Suena bien. La ordenaré.
¿Qué ordenó el hombre? Un hombre y una mujer están viendo el menú en un restaurante. ¿Qué ordenó el hombre?
¿Qué te gustaría ordenar?
Esta pizza se ve deliciosa. La ordenaré.
Yo comí pizza ayer, así que...
Ay, entonces, ¿cómo ves esta hamburguesa?
Suena bien. La ordenaré.
Un hombre le está hablando a una clínica por teléfono. ¿A qué hora tiene que ir el hombre al lugar? Hola, ¿cómo lo puedo ayudar?
¿Hasta qué hora están abiertos hoy?
Hasta las 6:00. Pero por favor, venga antes de las 5:30.
Está bien.
¿A qué hora tiene que ir el hombre al lugar? Un hombre le está hablando a una clínica por teléfono. ¿A qué hora tiene que ir el hombre al lugar? Hola, ¿cómo lo puedo ayudar?
¿Hasta qué hora están abiertos hoy?
Hasta las 6:00. Pero por favor, venga antes de las 5:30.
Está bien.
Un niño está leyendo su diario. ¿Qué fue lo primero que hizo el niño ese día?
El clima estuvo muy agradable hoy. Fui a la alberca esta tarde. Y fui a ver una película en la noche. También estudié en la mañana. Fue un muy buen día.
¿Qué fue lo primero que hizo el niño ese día? Un niño está leyendo su diario. ¿Qué fue lo primero que hizo el niño ese día?
El clima estuvo muy agradable hoy. Fui a la alberca esta tarde. Y fui a ver una película en la noche. También estudié en la mañana. Fue un muy buen día.
Una mujer y un hombre están viendo una foto. ¿Qué foto están viendo? Es una foto del equipo de fútbol de tu hijo, ¿no es así? ¿Cuál es tu hijo?
Este.
Ay, él es el más alto en el equipo.
Él es más alto que yo.
¿Qué foto están viendo? Una mujer y un hombre. Están viendo una foto. ¿Qué foto están viendo? Es una foto del equipo de fútbol de tu hijo, ¿no es así? ¿Cuál es tu hijo?
Este.
Ay, él es el más alto en el equipo.
Él es más alto que yo.
Top 10 phrases your parents always say. Let's go. Ve con cuidado. Be careful. Ve con cuidado. Be careful always, like before I leave home. Like my mother could tell that to me. Like always, always. Estate callado. Be quiet. Estate callado. Be quiet. I was a pretty quiet girl, so I didn't get that very much. Compórtate. Behave. Compórtate. Behave. I would get told that, like, if my parents left me with other people, like, they would tell me, like, compórtate. ¿Qué acabo de decir? What did I just say? ¿Qué acabo de decir? What did I just say? ¿Qué acabo de decir? Ve a la cama. Go to bed. Ve a la cama. Go to bed. Voy a contar hasta tres. I'm going to count to three. Voy a contar hasta tres. I'm going to count to three. Wow. They would tell me this every time. Like, and it's so scary. Like, one, uno, dos, tres. Yeah. Para. Stop. Para. Stop. Very simple but very effective word. ¿Qué has dicho? What did you say? ¿Qué has dicho? What did you say? So yeah, if the child says something inappropriate, like the parent would say, ¿qué has dicho? Para la televisión ahora. Turn the TV off now. Para la televisión ahora. Turn the TV off now. So I don't know if the kids now like watch as much TV as we used to. Like maybe now they are with their computers or their phones. So it would be like, apaga el ordenador ahora. Like, turn the computer off. ¿Te has cepillado los dientes? Did you brush your teeth? ¿Te has cepillado los dientes? Did you brush your teeth? Yeah, when I was a child, they would always remind me of that, like every night. Now I do it on my own. I don't need them to remind it to me.
10 words for connecting thoughts. So let's get started. Actualmente, currently. Actualmente hay un oso panda en el zoo. Currently, there's one panda bear in the zoo. Consecutivamente, consecutively. Cogió las llaves y consecutivamente se fue. He picked up the keys and consecutively he left. De hecho, in fact. Me gusta tu idea, de hecho, haremos eso. I like your idea. In fact, we'll do that. En efecto, indeed. En efecto, la solución es esa. The solution is that, indeed. Finalmente, finally. Finalmente, se dio por vencido. Finally, he gave up. No obstante, however. No obstante, compró el otro abrigo. However, he bought the other coat. Por lo tanto, therefore. No tengo dinero, por lo tanto, no puedo comprarlo. I don't have money, therefore, I cannot buy it. Por otra parte, on the other hand. Por otra parte, él también tiene razón. On the other hand, he is also right. Sin embargo, nevertheless, jugaron muy bien, sin embargo, perdieron. They played very well, nevertheless, they lost. También, also, ellos también quieren venir. They also want to come.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Want to finally start speaking in your target language? In this guide, you'll discover the top 7 ways to practice speaking on your own with our lessons. Let's begin. Number 1, shadowing. Shadowing is a proven learning technique where all you do is repeat what you hear in order to practice speaking. So access any audio or video lesson on the site and press the play button to start. Then, as you listen or watch, just repeat the conversations. Or, even easier, read along out loud with the dialogue section. The script is right there in front of you. With our lessons, you can master entire conversations, just like that. Number two, read out loud. I just mentioned it, but reading out loud is another powerful tactic and deserves its own mention. With every lesson, you get written transcripts and translations. So as you play the lesson, read the dialogue out loud as you hear it. Why? By reading out loud, you're also practicing your speaking skills. You can do this with the lesson notes, the lesson transcript, or the dialogue tool. With the dialogue tool, you can listen to each line again and again, and repeat out loud until you master them all. Number three, speed up your reading to speed up your speaking. Being able to speak without thinking is a sign of language mastery. If you're talking to a native and can respond quickly, they'll assume that you're fairly fluent. How can you do this? When you read out loud, try increasing your speed a little bit every time. So, start by reading with the dialogue tool. If you're like most learners, you'll read the first line slowly. That's because you're still getting used to the words, which is okay. Reread it. On your second try, you know most of the words, and you'll read a little faster. Reread it again. On your third try, you'll be even faster, at a native speaker's speed. And being able to read these phrases out loud and fast will help you speak fast. Number four, record and compare yourself with native speakers. In order to sound like a native speaker, you must imitate native speakers. So here's how. Access the voice recorder, which is in the dialogue study tool in every lesson. Click on the microphone icon. Listen to the native speaker's audio, and then record yourself. You can then compare the two recordings side by side, and practice and try again and again until you perfect your pronunciation. Number five, get feedback from our Premium Plus teacher. If you're learning by yourself and don't have access to real teachers, then you can always get feedback from our Premium Plus teachers. With the My Teacher tool, you can record yourself speaking and send the audio file to the teacher. They'll review it and tell you what to improve and how. That's it. Number six, level up your speaking with Premium Plus assignments. With Premium Plus, you can also get assignments that cover reading, writing, listening, and even speaking from your teacher. These assignments can be tailored to your goals and needs. You get a new one every week, or anytime you're ready for a new one. Number seven, get even more lessons in the lesson library. If you want even more lessons on speaking and conversations, visit our lesson library, and under category, choose conversation. You'll get all of the pathways and lessons that are focused on speaking.
The topic of today is the weather. The first word is fresco, which means cool, but only referred to the weather. A sentence with fresco could be hoy hace fresco. Today it is cool. Tormenta eléctrica, thunderstorm. You could normally only say tormenta instead of tormenta eléctrica. La tormenta asustó a mi hermana. The thunderstorm frightened my sister. The next word is claro, which means clear. El cielo está claro, which could be like the sky is clear. The next word is nublado, which means cloudy. Again, el cielo está nublado y creo que lloverá. The sky is cloudy and I think it will rain. The next word is soleado, which means sunny. Hoy está soleado e iré a dar un paseo. Today it is sunny and I will go for a walk. Week is at the office, so let's go. We have compañía, which means company. Mi padre no trabaja en una compañía. My father doesn't work in a company. The next word is horas extras, which is overtime. Tuve que trabajar 2 horas extra. I had to work like 2 hours overtime. I don't know how to translate that. The next word is reunión, which is meeting. Di una presentación en la reunión. I did a presentation in the meeting. The following word is salario, which means salary. Tiene un salario bajo, pero le gusta mucho su trabajo. He's got a low salary, but he really likes his job. The next word is compañero, which means colleague. Mis compañeros son muy simpáticos. My colleagues are very friendly. In the classroom, aula means classroom. So, éramos 20 alumnos en el aula. We were 20 students in the classroom. And the next word is estudiante, which means student. I have already used that word in the last sentence. Mi hermana es una estudiante de secundaria. My sister is a high school student. The next word is profesora, which means teacher, but female teacher. So if you want to say like a male teacher, you have to say profesor. Mi profesora de literatura era muy estricta. My literature teacher was very strict. The next word is deberes, which is homework. And you use this word with the verb hacer, do your homework. Todos los días tenía que hacer muchos deberes. Every day I had to do a lot of homework. The next word is libro de texto, which means textbook. And a sentence with it. Cada septiembre me encantaba comprar los nuevos libros de texto. So it's September. I loved buying the new textbooks.
It's home appliances. We have aire acondicionado, which is air conditioner. En Granada, sin aire acondicionado, en verano creo que moriría. In Granada, without air conditioner, in summer, I think I would die. It's true. The next word is aspiradora, vacuum. Hay alguien que no vacía la aspiradora después de usarla. There's someone who doesn't empty the vacuum after using it. The next word is frigorífico, which means refrigerator. Sometimes, I say frigo instead of frigorífico because it's too long. El frigorífico se rompió y tuvimos que tirar la comida. The refrigerator broke down and we had to throw away the food. The next word is lavadora, which is washing machine. En mi residencia no hay lavadoras. In my dorm, there aren't washing machines. The next word is ventilador, fan. En verano estoy pegada al ventilador. In summer, I'm stuck, glued to the fan. It's bugs. The next word is araña, spider. Me dan un poco de miedo las arañas. I'm a bit scared of spiders. Cucaracha, which means cockroach. En mi habitación en Tokio vi tres cucarachas. In my room in Tokyo, I saw three cockroaches and it was horrible. The next word is gusano, which is worm. Cuando era pequeña tenía una caja llena de gusanos de seda. When I was a child, I had a box full of silkworms. The next one is hormiga, which means ant. De pequeña vi millones de veces la película Hormigas. When I was a child, I watched a million times the film Ants. The next one is mosca, which means fly. Había una mosca un poco molesta en mi habitación. There was a quite disturbing fly in my room. And yeah, this is the end of today's Spanish Weekly Words. I hope you learned something. Have a nice day. Take care. Bye.
You just got a text message from your hotel's pickup service. What does the first number refer to? What does the first number refer to? The number in the text message refers to the customer code.
Código de cliente.
Friends of SpanishPod101.com. As you might already know, because we are famous, just kidding, I'm Efraín.
And I'm Diego.
And today we're gonna give you a top 10 of Mexican food street that you will find in Mexico City.
That's correct, so enjoy this video.
Woo! So this is gonna be a long list. At least for us, that because we haven't eaten yet. But it doesn't matter if you work in an office. It doesn't matter if you are a student. It doesn't matter your social status, neither your age. It doesn't matter if you are a grown-up or a child. Everyone, every citizen in Mexico City has already eaten street food, right?
That's correct, yeah. Now, we know that this food that we're going to show you, you can find it very easily in any restaurant in Mexico. However, we highly suggest that if you come here, you should try the street food in Mexico, because yeah, in our opinion, it is much better, it is tastier, but it is always cheaper. So please don't miss the opportunity to eat street food in Mexico. And let's start with a very typical dish here. And this dish is called quesadillas. By the way, everything here is going to be spoken in Spanish, so you can get familiar with the words that are used in this type of food. So, las quesadillas. Las quesadillas son básicamente una tortilla de maíz, y esa tortilla de maíz lleva por dentro queso, o quizás no queso, pero sí algún guisado. Por ejemplo, pollo. Pueden ser champiñones, puede ser flor de calabaza,
huitlacoche.
Puede ser huitlacoche, etc. Esta tortilla puede ser solamente asada en un comal, which is a type of pan, a huge pan, or even puede ser una tortilla frita. Oh, a mí personalmente me gustan más las quesadillas fritas. Oh, deliciosas, deliciosas. Ahora, las quesadillas también tienen una ligera variedad. Que es, pueden ser las quesadillas hechas a base de tortilla de harina de trigo. They taste all delicious. You should try them.
Okay. The second one is sopes. Los sopes están hechos de masa y son generalmente circulares. Ajá. Ahora, tienen un grosor de poco menos de medio centímetro, solamente unos milímetros. Y alrededor podemos encontrar que tienen ciertos bordes como pellizcos. Esto es para que no se les salga el relleno. La base puede ser de frijoles y también se le puede añadir pollo, lechuga, queso, chorizo. Se le pueden añadir muchas cosas y saben realmente deliciosos. Los sopes muchas veces los encontramos casi casi en el sur de México. Yo vivo en Guadalajara y ahí casi no se encuentran, ¿eh?
Es correcto, es correcto. Otra comida típica mexicana son los tlacoyos. Y los tlacoyos es masa de maíz en forma de rombo. Esta masa de maíz puede ser maíz blanco o maíz azul. Uh-huh. La masa azul en los tlacoyos es deliciosa. Y en esencia, estos tlacoyos tienen por dentro un poco de relleno que puede ser frijol, puede ser haba, Puede ser requesón, puede ser papa o incluso también chicharrón prensado. Generalmente las personas le ponen un poco de aceite y lo ponen a asar nuevamente en un comal. Y estos tlacoyos pueden ser acompañados con crema, con queso, con nopales, con cilantro picado, con cebollita. Y por supuesto no puede faltar la salsa verde o roja. ¡Oh, ya tengo mucha hambre!
¡Ay, qué delicia! Bien, otro platillo son las clásicas gorditas. Tal vez en nuestros videos hemos mencionado mucho las gorditas y aún no sabes qué es. Bueno, las gorditas están hechas de masa, también son circulares y estas generalmente están freídas en un comal, igualmente. Ya que están fritas, el en medio se rellena con pollo, se puede rellenar también con queso, pero también con carne. Aquí en el Distrito Federal, bueno, en la Ciudad de México, se rellenan con carne de suadero a veces, pero también se les puede poner cilantro, cebolla para acompañar, salsa o limón. Y ya quedó esa gordita bien rica. También puedes pagar un dinero extra para que le metan queso Oaxaca o quesillo.
Delicioso, delicioso. El siguiente tipo de comida son las clásicas flautas. Y una flauta es básicamente un taco alargado de entre 15 y 35, 40 centímetros. Pero es un taco frito. Por lo general dentro puede llevar pollo o carne deshebrada o también algunas personas le ponen papa. Y esto puede ir acompañado generalmente con crema, con queso, con lechuga y por supuesto con la clásica salsa verde o roja.
¡Mmm, qué rico!
Así es, un rápido tip, estas flautas las sirven en órdenes de tres y siempre, siempre consúmelas recién hechas, porque de otra forma la tortilla se ablandece y no es una sensación agradable.
No. Bien, el siguiente platillo son los amados huaraches. Los huaraches obtienen su nombre por su largo y parecido a las sandalias, que en México se les dice huaraches. Bien, los huaraches son una pieza de masa pues aplastada a tal punto que alcanza un largo de 30 centímetros y un grosor como de 15 o 10 centímetros. Entonces están rellenos de frijoles y también pueden llevar pollo, queso encima, lechuga y salsa también para acompañar. Su contenido no es tan diferente al de los sopes. Es similar.
Ahora, cuando cae la noche y tenemos un poco de frío, lo mejor que puedes encontrar en México son los clásicos elotes o esquites. Y los elotes pueden ser servidos de dos formas. Puede ser, número uno, hervidos, están en una olla y tú llegas con el elotero y le dices qué elote quieres y es casi todo un arte ver cómo saca el elote y le clava un palo de madera.
Claro.
Ahora, este elote generalmente lo puedes pedir con jugo de limón, con sal y con chile piquín en polvo. Delicioso. Otras personas más aventureras optan por ponerle mayonesa alrededor y también queso rallado. Es una delicia. La segunda forma de pedir un elote es un elote a las brasas, que es básicamente un elote un poco quemado, que lo sirven en una hoja de maíz. Y por lo general también tiene jugo de limón, chile piquín y también un poco de sal. Ahora, si no quieres un elote, también puedes pedir unos esquites, que es básicamente los granos del elote. Y tienen sal, tienen epazote y nuevamente también pueden llevar jugo de limón, chile piquín, sal. Pero sí sugiero que a estos esquites les pongas mayonesa y queso rallado. Es una delicia y créeme que con eso el frío que puedes sentir en la ciudad se te va a quitar por completo.
Claro, pero también cuando ataca el frío podemos consumir caldo de gallina, el cual está hecho de agua, con ajo, con cebolla y con grasa de pollo, y por supuesto va a contener también piezas de pollo, como pueden ser el ala de la gallina, la pierna, pero también la pechuga. Y también va a traer algunas verduras, como garbanzo y cebolla picada. Se le puede añadir también alguna salsa. Y bueno, esta también se caracteriza por encontrarse en algunas partes de la Ciudad de México. Yo recuerdo que mi papá me llevaba a un puesto de caldo de gallina todos los domingos en las mañanas. Y era fantástico y delicioso. Este caldo se consume generalmente en las mañanas. Ya más tarde es difícil encontrarlo.
La siguiente comida es un clásico antojo mexicano que podemos comer no importa si es la tarde o la noche o quizás muy, muy, muy en la noche. Y son los clásicos tacos al pastor. ¡Ay, los tacos al pastor! Estos tacos al pastor es una adaptación del shawarma árabe y es generalmente carne de cerdo que por lo general se sirve en tortillas, doble tortilla, de aproximadamente 8 centímetros de diámetro. Y este taco puede ir acompañado con piña, con cilantro, con cebolla y también hay una enorme variedad de salsas que le puedes poner. La más clásica, sin embargo, es la salsa roja, que es de chile de árbol. No olviden también a sus tacos ponerle un poco de limón y queda exquisito.
Bien, por otra parte también tenemos los tacos de canasta, pero también los tacos sudados. En su presentación en la calle los podemos encontrar en la parte trasera de una bicicleta en una canasta, que contiene desde 500 hasta 1000 tacos, y los cuales se van a acabar en 3 o 4 horas. A los lados de la canasta puede haber cubetas con salsa, con escabeche, con chiles en vinagre, también limón. Los tacos de canasta generalmente son de papa, papa con chorizo, frijoles, chicharrón prensado, también pueden tener carne de adobo o muchas cosas y muy muy ricas, ¿verdad, Diego?
Es correcto. Ah. ¿Y sabes qué? Ahora ya tengo muchísimo, muchísimo hambre. ¿Por qué no vamos a la calle a comprar un poco de verdadera comida callejera mexicana?
Pero estoy a dieta.
No importa, vamos.
Bueno.
That's it for today, my friends from SpanishPod101.com. I hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give it your thumbs up and share it with other learners who want to know about the food street in Mexico. And also, please, if you have any comment, opinion, or if you're planning to come to Mexico, please let us know right in the comments right below. So hopefully we can see you in our next video, guys.
Hasta luego.
Hi everybody, Rosa here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, how do you know when to use ser o estar? This can be confusing for Spanish learners, especially for native English speakers, because both ser and estar mean to be. First, let's go over the forms of ser. I am, yo soy, you are, singular, tú eres. He, she, is, you are, polite. Él, ella, usted, es. We are, nosotros somos, you are, plural. Vosotros sois, they are, you are, polite and plural. Ellos, ellas, ustedes, son. The different form of estar are. Yo estoy, for I am. Tú estás, for you are, singular. Él, ella, usted está, for he, she, is, you are, polite. Nosotros estamos, for we are. Vosotros estáis, for you are, in polite form. And ellos, ellas, ustedes están, for they are, you are, polite and plural. There is a subtle but simple difference between the two words for to be. Estar is for temporary conditions such as feelings and emotions, and that's why how are you is cómo estás. Ser is for characteristics or permanent states of being. For example, if I'd say I am American, I would say yo soy americano. Here's a good rule of thumb. Turn the sentence into a question. If the question uses how, the news start. And if it uses what, use se. Take the word callado, for example, which means quiet. Depending on which verb you use, the nuance will be different. If you say ella es callada, which uses se, that means she's quiet, as in she's a quiet person. On the other hand, if you say ella está callada, which uses the verb estar, that would mean she's being quiet. The nuance is that this situation is temporary and that she's just being quiet in this moment in time. Pretty cool, right? If you have any more questions, please leave a comment and I'll try to answer them. Hi everybody, Rosa here. Welcome to As a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, when do you use the conjunction U instead of O? First, let's go over some background information on how to use O. O is a conjunction in Spanish that means or. It's a conjunción coordinada disyuntiva, or disjunctive coordinating conjunction. That means it connects two different sentences and it used to give contrast or connect contrary opinions. An example of contrast could be: sal a trabajar ahora o no llegarás a tiempo. Meaning, go to work now or you are not going to be on time. Here, that means if part A, go to work, doesn't happen, part B, you are not going to be there on time, will happen. An example of connecting contrary opinions would be: ¿qué quieres de postre? ¿Helado o fruta? Meaning, what do you want for dessert? ¿Ice cream or fruit? This is the most common use of O. Now, on to the question for this lesson. O changes to U when or precedes a word that begins with an O sound. This includes H and O together because H is silent in Spanish. Let's go through some examples so you can learn when to use U instead of O. First up, más vale que vengas a la hora u otra persona te quitará el sitio. Meaning, you better come on time or another person is going to take your place. Here, the word otra, another, begins with an O sound. Therefore, we change O to U. Another example could be: puede utilizar esta mesa para jardín u hogar. Meaning, you can use this table for the garden or home. So why do the words change? That's easy, because it's easier to pronounce. How was this lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Hasta luego, see you later!
Welcome to Introduction to Spanish. My name is Alicia, and I'm joined by...
Hi everyone, I'm Leah.
In this lesson, you'll learn the basics of Spanish grammar. Word order refers to the order in which words are structured to form a sentence in a given language. Consider the English sentence, I read books. If we break down the English sentence, I read books, we can see that the subject I is presented first, followed by the verb read, and then finally the object, books, is positioned last. The basic word order for English, then, is subject, verb, object, or SVO for short.
Now, let's compare that same sentence, I read books, in Spanish. Yo leo libros. If we break down the Spanish sentence, we get the subject, yo, meaning I, then comes the verb, leo, meaning read, and finally we have the object, libros, meaning books. The word order for basic Spanish, then, is subject, verb, object, or SVO for short.
As you can see, the word order for sentences in Spanish is the same as that of English. This means that you can essentially swap out English words for Spanish words in an English sentence to convert it to Spanish. So imagine you wanted to say, I ate an apple, but in Spanish. Just swap out the words.
I, in Spanish, is yo. Ate, in Spanish, is comí. An is una, and apple is manzana. Altogether, it's yo comí una manzana.
So, I ate an apple in Spanish is...
Yo comí una manzana.
You can form nearly all basic sentences in Spanish just by following the SVO word order. We just saw how easy it was to form basic sentences in Spanish and how similar it was to forming basic English sentences. Luckily, it's actually even easier to form sentences in Spanish than it is in English. That's because Spanish is much more flexible when it comes to word order compared to English. Let's go back to the two examples we used earlier. More often than not, if we wanted to say, I read books and I ate an apple in Spanish, we would not usually say,
Yo leo libros. Yo comí una manzana.
But instead, we would just say,
Leo libros, comí una manzana.
Notice how the subject I is omitted from the sentence. This is how most Spanish sentences are constructed and spoken in real life.
When it's clear who or what the subject is, most Spanish speakers would omit the subject altogether. Yo leo libros and yo comí una manzana would only be used if the subject is unclear or if you wanted to place a stronger emphasis on the subject, as if to say, I am the one who reads books, or I was the one who ate the apple.
So, most of the time, we can actually express any simple action in Spanish with just two words, the verb and the object in Spanish. So far, we've only looked at affirmative sentences in Spanish. But what if you wanted to make the sentence negative?
Well, that's very easy as well. All you have to do is just add no before the verb, and that's it.
So, I don't read books would be...
No leo libros. Same thing for I didn't eat an apple. Just add no before the verb. No comí una manzana. And that's all there is to it.
Once again, it's much simpler to form questions in Spanish than it is in English.
There's actually a variety of different methods of forming a question in Spanish. Let's go through some of them. Will seem a little strange if we ask our own selves a question in Spanish. So let's introduce a new subject. Let's go with Juan, a very typical Spanish name. So instead of I read books, we now have Juan reads books. Juan lee libros.
The simplest way we can turn that statement into a question is by just raising our intonation at the end of the sentence.
Juan lee libros? Meaning, does Juan read books?
In conversation, we just need to raise the intonation at the end to express that it's a question. In writing, however, we have to include the question mark at the end, just like in English. But unlike English, questions in Spanish are marked with an inverted question mark at the beginning of the question as well.
¿Juan lee libros?
Another simple way we can turn a statement into a question is by adding a question tag at the end of a sentence. One question tag in English, for example, is right? Something something statement, right? It works in exactly the same way in Spanish.
Juan lee libros, ¿no? Juan reads books, doesn't he?
The final way to make a sentence in Spanish is to actually switch the verb and the subject. So statements in Spanish would normally be SVO, but to formulate a question, it'll be VSO. The verb and subject are switched.
¿Lee Juan libros? Meaning, does Juan read books?
All of these questions mean the same thing, but they're not completely identical. There are tiny nuances that go along with the method you use to formulate a question.
The first and last examples appear to have exactly the same meaning, but Juan lee libros places a greater emphasis on Juan because the subject appears first in the sentence, as opposed to lee Juan libros, where the emphasis is on the verb.
As you can see, there are many ways to form basic questions in Spanish. In this lesson, you learned about the word order of Spanish, how to form affirmative and negative sentences, about the omission of the subject and how to form questions. We've covered only the very basics of Spanish grammar. If you're interested in learning more, check out our Spanish in 3 Minutes video series. In that course, we teach you useful phrases while covering the fundamentals of Spanish grammar, and each lesson is only 3 minutes long.
Hi everybody, Rosa here. Welcome to Ask a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, what are some popular Spanish idioms? In English, we have our fair share of idioms like it's raining cats and dogs, or even what's up. Here are some Spanish idioms you should know. Number 10 is estar empanado, meaning to be spaced out. Literally, it means to be breaded. In Spain, we have a lot of breaded foods like la empanada gallega, So every time your mind freezes and you can think, you're getting empanado or empanada. Number 9 is dormir como un tronco, meaning to sleep like a trunk. This means that you slept very well. For example, he dormido como un tronco, meaning I slept like a trunk. Number 8, chorizo, means sausage. And if you are carnivorous, you are going to find Spanish chorizo delicious. But don't be surprised if you hear this word in reference to a person. That means they are a thief, burglar, or swindler. Number 7 is one that doesn't make much sense, but you'll often hear. It is hace un tiempo de perros. Literally, it's a dog weather, meaning it's terrible weather. Number 6 is a phonetic challenge. ¿Qué chorrada? Chorrada, wow, sounds difficult. We have the CH and a double R. So what does chorrada mean? If we say, ¿qué chorrada?, we are expressing that something is not important, has no sense, or is absurd. Number 5 is costar un ojo de la cara, which means it's ridiculously expensive, but it literally means it costs an eye out of the head. Number 4, aprobar por los pelos, literally means to pass by the hair, referring to an exam. If you say aprobé por los pelos, you're saying that you got the lowest score or close to it, but passed the exam. Hopefully, you don't use this expression too much. Number 3 is qué guay, meaning cool. Here, we have a very useful multipurpose word. Do you want to go to the beach? Guay. Do you like my trousers? Qué guays. How was the party last night? Muy guay. It's similar to good, okay, perfect, or beautiful. However, be careful. It should only be used in casual or colloquial situations. Number 2 is tener un cacao. Literally translated, it means to have a cacao. However, the real meaning is to have a lot of trouble or to be in a mess. Lastly, number 1 is tener el guapo subido, which literally means to have the good looking up. The meaning of this may be easy for you to guess. You can use this phrase when suddenly one of your friends looks stunning. ¿Te ha pasado algo bueno? Hoy tienes el guapo subido. Did anything good happen to you? Today you're looking handsome. How was this lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Please leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Hasta luego, see you later.
Hola a todos, soy Lucía. Hi everybody, I'm Lucía. Welcome to SpanishPod101.com, Español en 3 minutos, the fastest, easiest, and most fun way to learn Spanish. In the last lesson, we learned how to show thanks by saying gracias. In this lesson, we will learn some of the most common greetings used in Spanish. ¿Están listos? Are you ready? Empecemos, let's start. The most used informal greeting is hola. Hola. Hola means hi or hello. We can use it in formal and informal situations, at any time of day. It's very convenient. Hola. Now, let's look at some greetings that are used at certain times of day. First is good morning. Good morning in Spanish is buenos días. Buenos días. Buenos días literally means good day, but we use it to mean good morning. During the day, we say buenas tardes. Buenas tardes. Buenas tardes means good afternoon. This can be used all day as long as it's light outside. Again, buenas tardes. When it starts to get dark, you can switch to this. Buenas noches. Buenas noches. Buenas noches means good evening or good night, depending on the situation. If you're greeting someone in the evening, it means good evening. If you're speaking to someone before you go to sleep, it means good night. Again, that's buenas noches. Now, you can greet people in many different ways in Spanish. Let's review them all again. As a general greeting, hola. In the morning, buenos días. In the afternoon or during the day, buenas tardes. In the evening or at night, buenas noches. Pretty easy, right? Now it's time for Lucia's insights. If you're not sure which greeting is right to use, buenos días, buenas tardes, or buenas noches, just remember that hola can be used at any time of day. During the next lesson, you will learn the meaning of habla inglés. Do you already know it? In our next lesson, you will learn this phrase and more. Hasta la próxima. See you then.
Want to speak real Spanish from your first lesson? Sign up for your free lifetime account at SpanishPod101.com.
Hello, this is Rosa. Welcome to Spanish Top Words. Today we'll be doing must-know expressions for agreeing and disagreeing. ¿Puedo añadir algo aquí? Can I add something here? ¿Puedo añadir algo aquí? Can I add something here? So it's a polite way to interrupt someone who's talking. ¿Qué opinas? What do you think? ¿Qué opinas? What do you think? Always nice to ask for others' opinions. Así es exactamente como me siento. That's exactly how I feel. Así es exactamente como me siento. That's exactly how I feel. Yeah, nice expression to agree with someone when you're having like a deeper conversation, I would say. Eso es cierto. That's true. Eso es cierto. That's true. You're learning Spanish. That's true. Es cierto. No estoy de acuerdo. No. I don't agree. No. No estoy de acuerdo. No. I don't agree. No. One time is not enough. You have to, like, repeat it at the end. No hay duda de eso. No doubt about it. No hay duda de eso. No doubt about it. So if someone would tell me, like, oatmeal is an awesome breakfast food, I could say, no doubt about it. No hay duda de eso. No podría estar más de acuerdo contigo. I couldn't agree with you more. No podría estar más de acuerdo contigo. I couldn't agree with you more. Sushi is the best food ever. I couldn't agree with you more. No podría estar más de acuerdo contigo. Sí, tienes razón. Yes, you're right. Sí, tienes razón. Yes, you're right. SpanishPod101.com is the best way to learn Spanish. Yes, you're right. Vamos a seguir adelante, ¿vale? Let's just move on, shall we? Vamos a seguir adelante, ¿vale? Let's just move on, shall we? If some discussion is getting a little bit too heated at some point, you just can say that and try to move on to another topic. Exactamente. Exactly. Exactamente. Exactly. He should take better care of his health. Exactly. Exactamente. And this is the end. Today we did must-know expressions for agreeing and disagreeing. I hope you liked them. Tell us which one was your favorite. Please don't forget to check out SpanishPod101.com and please subscribe to this channel. Bye! Hasta pronto! Hi everyone, I'm Rosa and today we'll be doing the 10 phrases you always want to hear in Spanish. So let's begin! El presupuesto es ilimitado. The budget is unlimited. For example, if you are at a fancy restaurant and the other person tells you the budget is unlimited. El presupuesto es ilimitado. You can eat all you want. Yay! Eres una excelente cocinera. You are an excellent cook. It always feels nice to know that you can do like tasty things. Habrá un extra al final de mes, which means there'll be a bonus at the end of the month. Sounds great! Te echo de menos. I miss you. I haven't met you, but I miss you already. Te traje algo especial. I brought you something special. What could it be? Te ves muy bien hoy. You look great today. You look great today. All of you. Yes, you! Tenías razón. You were right. It always feels good to be right. Yeah. Y tú ganas, which means, and you win. And what is it that I win? Te quiero, which means I love you. Well, in my case, I love the viewers that leave me nice comments. Eres tan inteligente. Which is, you are so smart. This is the end of today's 10 phrases you always want to hear in Spanish. I hope you like them. Thank you very much for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe. Bye. Eres una persona creativa. You are a creative person. One of the compliments I like to hear the most. Oh, no, please.
Hello, my friends of SpanishPod101.com. Today, we have a very special video. My name is Diego.
And I'm Efraín.
And we are going to see 5 Mexican movies
that you will find very helpful for you to understand vocabulary and comprehension.
And also Mexican expressions for you to talk with your Mexican friend, of course. So,
yes.
Enjoy the video.
Enjoy it, eh? So, we are recommending you these movies not just because they will help you to understand the Mexican culture, but because they will help you to increase your vocabulary set and to hear different accents around Mexico. For example, we could imitate the accent of the high-class boys and girls, as we call it in Mexico, chicos fresas or chicas fresas. And I could make a voice like this. Ay, o sea, güey, se pasó de lanza ese vato. Güey, ¿por qué no se buscó un bosque y se perdió, güey?
Nice. And sometimes we can kind of imitate the accent of the low-class people in Mexico. Pues, chale, si no querías que te parlara, pues nada me lo hubieras dicho ya, güey.
Well, and we are not professional doing that. We are actually very bad actors, and we are gonna leave you in good hands. So we're gonna start with the first one. Oh, but we know that this is a channel for learning in Spanish. So we are making this list in Spanish.
That's correct. Yeah, but don't worry, because we highly suggest you watch this video without the subtitles. But if you have any question about what we said, you can use them. We will hard code it right here.
Okay. Y la primera película es Amores Perros. Y Amores Perros sucede en la Ciudad de México. 3 historias se unen a partir de un choque automovilístico. Esta es una película que nos enseña lo difícil de la vida humana. O como decimos aquí en México, lo perra de la vida humana. Es una historia audaz, intensamente emocional, pero también muy ambiciosa. Y bueno, te recomiendo que la veas. Realmente es muy cruda, pero también entretenida. Y, ¿por qué no? Puedes comprender un poco más de la vida aquí en la Ciudad de México.
Correcto, correcto. Otra excelente película es Y tu mamá también. Personalmente es una de las películas mexicanas que más me gusta. Y es básicamente la historia de 2 chicos mexicanos llamados Tenoch y Julio que compiten por el afecto de una chica española que conocen en una boda de un familiar suyo. Esta chica resulta que es muy atractiva y pues bueno, esos 2 chicos mexicanos para intentar impresionarla le invitan a un imaginario viaje a una playa que no existe y que se llama supuestamente Boca del Cielo. Y bueno, en el viaje pues prácticamente hay un torbellino de emociones intensas.
La siguiente es una película icónica y muy reconocida en México y en algunas partes del mundo, y es El Crimen del Padre Amaro. Puede que a muchos no les guste, puede que otros la amen, pero todos la conocen. Y el crimen del padre Amaro trata sobre un padre, un joven de 24 años, recién ordenado sacerdote, que llega a una parroquia de un pueblo donde el padre se llama Benito, quien recibe fondos tal vez de los narcotraficantes, pero también llega a conocer al padre Natalio, quien se sospecha que ayuda a los guerrilleros. Bien, mientras tanto, el padre Amaro empieza una relación amorosa con Natalia, una chica de 16 años, y todo va bien, pero se complica cuando Natalia queda embarazada. El padre Benito recibe ciertas amenazas y el padre Natalio pues está acusado y está bajo la mira y tal vez quede excomulgado. Bien, toda esta historia tiene mucha drama, está cargada de muchas emociones y todo termina cuando el padre Amaro le pide a Natalia que aborte al bebé.
Es una historia muy fuerte, pero también es muy conocida en México, pero también en otras partes del mundo. Bien, la siguiente película es una también muy icónica aquí en México, que todo buen mexicano ha visto, y se llama Sexo, Pudor y Lágrimas. Sexo, Pudor y Lágrimas es una cinta en donde podemos ver tragedia, pero también diversión y al mismo tiempo una constante búsqueda de salir de la cotidianidad de tres parejas que son los principales personajes de esta historia. Podemos decir que es una cinta que no te va a dejar ni un solo segundo tranquilo, porque está cargada de mucha emoción y además es una historia que se desarrolla en la ciudad, una de las ciudades más grandes del mundo, es decir, en la Ciudad de México. Podríamos decir que es una visión actual sobre la batalla de los sexos, hombres contra mujeres. Es muy recomendada y te aseguro que esta película no te va a defraudar.
La última, que es la favorita de nosotros dos y es la más reciente, a pesar de que son películas actuales, pero esta es la más reciente y se llama Nosotros los Nobles. Y cuenta la historia acerca de tres chicos que despilfarran el dinero del padre. Un día el padre se da cuenta de que hizo hijos buenos para nada y decide quitarles el acceso a la herencia familiar. Y bueno, hay una serie de cosas que pasan ahí que no me arriesgo a contarles, porque si no les contaría la trama de la historia. Y tienen que verlo, es muy divertido, tiene además mucho vocabulario, y en particular yo me declaro fan de Javi Noble.
Ah, yo también, creo que muchos mexicanos nos sentimos identificados, nos gusta mucho ese personaje. Perfecto, chicos. So, well, now, I know that these are just 5 movies, but these suggestions are really, really, really good examples of what Mexican movies are like. But don't worry, because if you like these 5 movies, we will make another video with even more Mexican movies that we truly, truly love. That's it for today, my friends of SpanishBowl101.com. We hope that you have enjoyed this video. If so, please give it your thumbs up and share with other learners who might want to know some Mexican movies, some very good Mexican movies. Also, please, if you have any comment or opinion or something, please let us know in the comment section right below. We do read them and reply to them. See you in our next video, guys.
Hasta luego.
Hi, everyone. I'm Rosa. Today, we'll be doing 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. So, let's begin.
El español es divertido y fácil de aprender.
Spanish is fun and easy to learn.
El español es divertido y fácil de aprender.
Spanish is fun and easy to learn.
I think the pronunciation is very easy in Spanish. Yeah.
Aparte de saber español, también puedo hablar algunos otros idiomas.
Apart from knowing Spanish, I can speak a few other languages as well.
Aparte de saber español, también puedo hablar algunos otros idiomas.
Apart from knowing Spanish, I can speak a few other languages as well. Tell me which other languages you can speak. I can speak English. Yeah, a bit of Japanese and French, but yeah, I have to study more.
Estoy aprendiendo español por mí mismo.
I'm learning Spanish all by myself.
Estoy aprendiendo español por mí mismo.
I'm learning Spanish all by myself. So good for you. Like, I know it's hard, but if you are, I don't know, if you are constant and you do something every day, I think you can also like learn languages by yourself. Like today there are so many resources on the internet. And...
Hablaré español como un nativo en 3 años. I'll speak Spanish like a native speaker in 3 years. Hablaré español como un nativo en 3 años. I'll speak Spanish like a native speaker in 3 years.
Oh, good luck!
He estado aprendiendo español por 10 años. I've been learning Spanish for 10 years. He estado aprendiendo español por 10 años. I've been learning Spanish for 10 years.
Yeah, I must have been studying English for longer than that.
Me tomó solo un año para hablar fluidamente. It took me only 1 year to become fluent. Me tomó solo un año para hablar fluidamente. It took me only 1 year to become fluent.
Wow. I admire you so much.
Gracias, pero en realidad no soy un hablante nativo. Thank you, but I'm not a native speaker, actually.
Gracias, pero en realidad no soy un hablante nativo. Thank you, but I'm not a native speaker, actually. Tell me your secrets.
Puedo memorizar alrededor de 50 palabras nuevas en español al día. I can memorize around 50 new Spanish words a day.
Puedo memorizar alrededor de 50 palabras nuevas en español al día.
I can memorize around 50 new Spanish words a day.
Wow. It's important to be constant. Yeah. Just be sure to revise, like, the words you had studied before so you don't forget.
Puedo ver películas en español sin subtítulos. I can watch Spanish movies without subtitles.
Puedo ver películas en español sin subtítulos.
I can watch Spanish movies without subtitles.
I still use subtitles for English.
Sé cómo conjugar todos los verbos irregulares.
I know how to conjugate all the irregular verbs.
Sé cómo conjugar todos los verbos irregulares.
I know how to conjugate all the irregular verbs. Yeah, there are a lot of them, so that would be great if you knew how to did all of them right. There might even be Spanish people who cannot do that properly in some cases, so. This is the end of today's 10 phrases to amaze native speakers. So I hope you get the chance to use them. Thank you for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Bye. Yeah, I can. Teach me.
Hi, everybody. Rosa here. Welcome to As a Teacher, where I'll answer some of your most common Spanish questions. The question for this lesson is, when are the prepositions por and para used? The prepositions por and para are a little difficult for Spanish learners, because both are used in similar contexts and have similar meanings. In English, the prepositions por and para are frequently translated as for, by, and to. Let's go over por and para so you can learn how to use them correctly. Por comes from the Latin word pro, meaning for, while para is formed from the combination of the Latin prepositions pro and ad, which mean for and to, respectively. Por is frequently used to express a cause, such as viajo por placer, meaning I travel for pleasure, a place, such as camino por la calle, meaning I walk down the street, a period of time, por las mañanas voy a la universidad, in the morning I go to college, a medium, te enviaré el paquete por mensajero, I'll send the package by courier, a substitution or equivalence, haré los deberes por ti, I will do the task for you, en passive voice, el almuerzo fue preparado por mi madre, lunch was prepared by my mother. Para is used for utility. Estas zapatillas son para correr, meaning these shoes are for running. Direction. Voy para Europa en vacaciones. I'm going to Europe on vacation. Here, it can be replaced by con destino a, which means bound for. Time limitation. Son 10 para las 5. It's 10 minutes to 5. Here, the difference is that we use para when time is fixed or when there's a deadline. Opinion. Para mí, que perderán el juego. I think that they will lose the game. Literally, for me, that they will lose the game. And goal or destination. To where or to whom it goes. As in, saldré a caminar para respirar aire fresco. Meaning, I will go for a walk to get some fresh air. Here, the goal is to get fresh air. The most challenging point may be to identify when to use por instead of para. Just keep in mind that por is used more frequently to talk about a medium to do something. As in, te llamaré por teléfono, I will call you by phone. Another common usage is to refer to something unspecific, either time or place. For example, estoy por tu casa, meaning I'm around, close to your house. Or llegaré por la tarde, meaning I will arrive around the afternoon. Para, on the other hand, is more often used to talk about the purpose or destination of something. As in, este libro es para la clase, meaning this book is for the class. Or voy para tu casa, meaning I'm going to or in direction to your house. How was this lesson? Pretty interesting, right? Do you have any more questions? Leave them in the comments below and I'll try to answer them. Hasta luego, see you later.
Hi everyone, this is Rosa and today I'll be teaching you 15 ways to remember words, and these ways were submitted by fans. So let's start. A menudo veo vídeos en la televisión o YouTube que están diseñados para los niños pequeños. I often watch TV or YouTube videos that are designed for young children. Yeah, I think it's a really good way. Like, also when I want to learn a new language, like, I watch some cartoons because they are always easier. And I think that really helps. Aprendo sobre las raíces de las palabras y cómo las diferentes palabras se relacionan entre sí. I learned about the roots of words and how different words are related to each other. Yeah, I think it might make easier if you know why the words are formed like that. So if you know that, you can then like know how to form the words and everything gets easier. Asocio nuevas palabras con historias, juegos o películas. I associate new words with stories, games or movies. It's always a good way to remember, like to associate things like these mnemotechnical, strategies. Like, for example, to remember kanji in Japanese, there are some books that relate like each ideogram with like a kind of story. So then you remember the meaning and everything. And it's quite useful. It works. Asocio nuevas palabras con palabras que suenan similares en mi idioma natal. I associate new words with words that sound similar in my native language. Well, this might work for some languages, but I don't know if this works for all of them. For example, Spanish and English, I think that would work. Asocio palabras con dibujos, fotos y escenas divertidas. I associate words with drawings, pictures, and funny scenes. So yeah, I think this is more appropriate for what I said before, like the kanji. Some of them you can kind of infer what they are, like what they mean. Like if you have like a drawing, like they are similar to what they mean. So I guess that. Clasifico nuevas palabras con otras palabras relacionadas que ya conozco. I categorize new words with other related words that I already know. Yeah, I think it makes it easier if you can kind of classify and order things. Escucho canciones y me aprendo las letras. I listen to songs and memorize the lyrics. I think this is a really good way also. It's a way that you enjoy, like you like this, to listen to these songs and everything. So I think it comes to you like easier. You're not doing that much of an effort maybe, like because you're having fun. Hablo tan a menudo como sea posible con los nativos del idioma. I speak as often as possible with native speakers. Yeah, I think this is the best thing you can do. I mean, you can like read as many books as you want and listen to films or songs or everything, but to really learn a language, like you need to like speak it with native people. Leyendo lo más posible, en especial el periódico, me ayuda a recordar palabras. Reading as much as possible, especially the newspaper, helps me to remember words. Like if you see the same word like used a lot of times, like you get to remember that more easily than if you just have a, like a list of words and try to memorize every of them. And also you are seeing these words in a context, so you know how to use them and how they are used by the people. So it's a good way. Soy persistente en la práctica diaria hablando con mi familia o con mis perros, a pesar de que no me entienden. I am persistent in practicing every day by talking to my family or my dogs, even though they don't understand me. Why not? Well, you can also talk to yourself, right? But yeah, it's very important to be constant. I think it's like the most important point. Like you have to be constant to learn a language. You just cannot study it for a week and then, okay, the next month I will study a bit more. Like you have to be constant. Trato de usar el lenguaje de forma cotidiana en el contexto de la vida cotidiana. I try to use the language routinely in the context of daily life. It's important to try to use it as much as you can, I guess. Because sometimes you have to adapt the language depending on their situation, depending on who you are talking to. So it's important to know how you really use the language in your daily life, like how it changes on. Like not learning just by from some book, but learning it in like practicing in your day-to-day life. Yo uso la repetición, leyendo, escribiendo y hablando las palabras una y otra vez. I use repetition, reading, writing and speaking words over and over again. I used to do that. The only problem is that I normally forget like pretty quickly after that, but well, maybe there are some people that... Well, I guess if you do that in a constant way, like... It's not like you repeat these words one day and then don't do that after that. Maybe if you do, if you go back to these words, like it can help you. I think it can be a good way then. Yo digo palabras en voz alta para poder realmente escucharlas. I say words out loud so that I can actually hear them. It's very important because sometimes we don't say them out loud and then we are kind of afraid to pronounce it. We don't really know how to do it, so it's nice to know. Even if you can, like, record yourself with a mic or something, so you can hear yourself talking and you can know, like, whether you are pronouncing it right or not. Yo intento pensar en español para que se incorpore naturalmente a mi proceso de pensamiento. I try to think in Spanish so it becomes natural to my thought process. Well, it's fine. It's like you're using Spanish in... during your day, so like if you're thinking in Spanish, you are also thinking in ways you can form new sentences and use the words you learned. So yeah, I think it's a good way. Like if you don't have anyone to talk to in Spanish, it can also be nice to try to like talk to yourself and make your sentences. And usar tarjetas, use flashcards. I have like some apps in my mobile phone, so especially to learn Japanese. It's really helpful. Like they show you new words and the translation. Then you get these flashcards repeated, and depending on whether you are answering them right or not, like they show you these cards more often or not. So yeah, I think it really helps to memorize words. So this is the end of today's 15 ways to remember words submitted by fans. I hope you liked it. If you have any other ways to memorize words, please tell us. And thank you for watching. Please don't forget to subscribe. Bye.
Want to speed up your language learning? Take your very first lesson with us. You'll start speaking in minutes and master real conversations. Sign up for your free lifetime account. Just click the link in the description.